Hello everyone and welcome to our class in Artificial Intelligence and Machine Learning in Finance. In this video, we want to learn more about the applications of classification trees. So we'll have a look at the use of regression trees, classification trees, tree models in general, and we will again use the credit card customer dataset from our previous examples, where we saw how it can be used to exemplify classification made by support vector machines and k-nearest neighbor models. So we are going to predict customer churn. It's a classification we want to forecast. We want to predict the termination of contracts by customers for our credit card company. And to provide a more complete picture, we will also employ boosted decision trees. So these are special kind of random trees, of random forests. We'll see how actually the initial models, the initial classification trees do not significantly improve on the performance of support vector machines and k-nearest neighbor models, but later on we'll see that if we employ boosted decision trees, yes, we can achieve some increase in accuracy. And in the regression task later on, we will forecast health insurance premium. In this case, we have a metric response variable in contrast to the binary one in the previous customer churn example, where it's only about termination, no termination. And both data samples are available at Kaggle. And actually, if you have a cursor, if you take the cursor here, you can actually see that we've linked, included the link here at Kaggle for both the customer churn data and the insurance premium. Okay, so we'll start with the classification task. Again, a short reminder, if you haven't watched the other video, what the credit card customer data set is all about. It's a data sample, approximately 10,000 observations. And you, as the manager, you're responsible for looking out for the customers. And you are worried that an increasing number of customers quit your services, terminate the contract. And you want to slow down customer churn. So she wants to proactively contact customers who are about to leave their credit card services to change their decision. So actually you're trying to actively influence the behavior of your customers based on a prediction of whether he or she is likely to terminate the contract. Therefore, the manager needs predictions on who is going to quit the services. So you want to classify those observations. The data set includes more than 10,000 observations. You have features like age, salary, credit card limit, and other features. There's a D missing. And the data is unbalanced with only about 16% of the customers having churned. We've already talked about this class imbalance problem a little bit. This led to the fact that in the previous lecture, where we use support vector machines and k-nearest neighbor models, actually the accuracy wasn't perfect because of the few observations we have where customers actually terminated the contract. So we start again with importing the data and pre-processing the data. You can also skip to a slide 220 and the following ones, where you can see it, we did the same in our previous example. You can download the CSV file from this link. You need to import the CSV file. Actually, again, a reminder that in many instances when using R, a CSV file is actually the best choice because it includes as few graphical additional information and layouting as possible. So it's the pure data. That's why CSV files are actually a nice input format for many statistics programs. We dropped the last two columns according to the data set description. We don't need those two columns. And then bank churners, that's the object we create from the object we've imported. And this is in line 8 here. Let me highlight this for you. Actually, we are dropping the last two columns. So we are only using columns 1, 2, the number of columns minus 2. So for example, if the original object included 10 columns. We are now using only the first 8 ones. Okay. We then opposed to the k nearest neighbor and the SVM example, we do not exclude categorical features. We can actually work with them here. So what we do is we create the training set and the test set. We randomly select 80% of the observations for the training set, and the remaining 20% are included in the test set. And we include the client number, which is a number for identifying individual customers. It has no predictive value because it doesn't carry any economic information. And we use the DPLYR library. Again, we use the set seed command in order to be able to replicate the results. And then we set the training set and the test set. Okay, so what we do is we sample integers, we include our 80%, 20%, and then we select based on the client number. That's what we do in line 7. Same with the test set, and then of course we need the same for the response variables. So y train and y test are again the response values in the training and the test sample. Now, decision trees do not require feature scaling because they are not sensitive to the variance in the data. That's why we do not need to scale our observations, as we've done before in the previous lecture on the support vector machines. Now, we fit the classification tree. Again, as is common in many of our machine learning algorithms, we need to select the hyperparameter, which is the parameter that governs the training, the learning process. So we again use the caret library, and we do this in parallel. We use cross-validation, as you might know by now. Train control is the function in caret to select the method for hyperparameter training. And what we do here is tenfold cross-validation. Set seed in line 4. If again you encounter any problems with the parallelization, just comment these two two lines out. And then tree model is we train based on x train, with the response being y train. The method is r part, which is of course for partitioning. The tune length is 20, and the training trees is relatively fast, so we can actually consider more possible values. And TR control is what we set in line 3. That's our option for using 10-fold cross-validation to select the hyperparameter. And the metric that is used for training is the accuracy, and then we stop the cluster in line 12. What happens here if we print out the tree model and the best tuning parameter? It is the complexity, which is given by an optimal parameter here of 0.00285 and so on. And as you can see from the plot here, with increasing complexity, you actually get fewer accuracy from cross-validation. So this is what comes out if we plot tree model, and this complexity parameter CP is the minimum improvement required at each node to make a further split. So remember that we are trying to train a tree here, meaning that at each level, at each node, you need to decide whether you want to go one level deeper, or if you say, okay, this is enough, the tree is deep enough, we have enough accuracy. So this parameter balances possible reductions in the classification error via further splits against the complexity of the model, which is the number of splits or the depth of the tree. And a high value of the CP of the complexity parameter leads to more shallow trees, while a low value yields deeper trees that might overfit. And on the following slides, we'll exemplify this so that you can get an idea of what happens. Now, the rpart plots, R package, provides quite a convenient visualization of tree models. However, It requires a tree model that was fitted by our part directly and not in the carrot package. So therefore, we again fit the same model using just a different package in R, and with the optimal parameters determined in the hyperparameter tuning step. So we basically get the same model just with a different package, but in this package we are able to do some nice plots in R. So this is what we do. We visualize this best param tree model, and then the tree model is initialized with R part. Again, we need R part.plot as the package, and then we can plot it. And the result is shown on this slide. Now, if you have the slides, you can actually zoom in here, but I can do this here as well. I hope I can show you this, yes. So we start out here, existing customer, and we have 100%, total trans CT, and we have total trans AMT, total transaction, total relationship count, and you can see those numerous features we have. Customer age, there's quite clear, customer age being large or equal than 37, total revolving balance. These are all the cutoffs, and in the end you get a tree that looks like this. So if you zoom in or do it at home with the same code, you get this tree. As one can see, this is actually quite deep. Now we will now raise the complexity parameter to obtain a more shallow tree. So we multiply the complexity parameter from the current tree with 50 and do the same again. And what you get is on the next slide here. You can see total transaction CT, that's the total transaction count, and the total revolving balance on the credit card. Again, these two are quite high up in the tree, but this is where the partitioning stops. That's the whole tree. So actually we have the customer, if this total transaction count is smaller than 55, yes or no, we get a prediction here. We have an attrited customer, existing customer, existing customer. So this is the whole tree, quite shallow. And that's because we increased the complexity parameter. Okay, now let's talk a little bit about the cutoff level. Now, classification in each node is, as I mentioned in the previous video, performed by a majority vote. However, it is possible and sometimes even useful to choose a cutoff level that is different from 50%. So it's not 50% and 1, then it's class 1, otherwise it's class 0. You can also vary this cutoff level, and we can influence the sensitivity and the specificity by choosing a different cutoff level. And the accuracy closely follows specificity due to the class imbalance in the data. And this is shown on the training data in the deeper tree in this plot. You can see in red the specificity, in blue the sensitivity, and black is the accuracy. You can see that if you take different cutoff probabilities, probably you shouldn't use 0 or close to 0 or close to 1, but as you can see, it's not constant for all these different cutoff probabilities, but actually there might be a choice that increases the accuracy or the sensitivity of your model. Okay, so what's the predictive performance of this classification tree? We rely on the model determined via cross-validation, which is the deeper tree. We don't use the shallow one with only two levels. Again, we use predict, and we print the confusion or error matrix based on the test data sample, and this is what we get. We get in the confusion matrix 252 and 1677 customers which have been classified correctly. The accuracy thus is 93%, sorry, with this confidence interval. And corresponding information on the no information rate, kappa, sensitivity, and so on. So the predictive performance is actually comparable to the one of the support vector machine that uses a non-linear radial kernel. See also slide 248. But we can do even more. And this is what we do in the next video. We will use random forest, we will use boosting, and then also come back to the regression example to improve the prediction accuracy of this classification tree.